I'm Jake Seward, Global Head of Communications here at the firm. I'm delighted to be joined by my former colleague and the former mayor of Chicago, Rahm Emanuel. Rahm, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks, Jake.
So Rahm has written a book, The Nation's City, Why Mayors Are Now Running the World. Why did you write the book?
So I could be here with you. So basically, I think we've done this before as a country, but this has a slightly different twist to it. You have basically a dysfunctional federal government. It's also a dysfunctional Brussels, a dysfunctional London. And the center of gravity of politics has moved to local government. And when you really think about where you work, where you live, where you send your kids to school, how you get to and from work, the benefits of the community, et cetera, libraries, parks, et cetera, those are all services that are delivered local government. What's slightly different, or another layer on top of that, things that used to be left to the national government, and you still need them, is climate change. Cities are taking the lead on that. Integration on immigration, in the sense of, like in Chicago, not different from New York, we have 147 languages spoken in our public schools. So how do you create that sense of community? An inclusive economics growth strategy that has all communities participating and growing. Things that used to be kind of like the model city out of Lyndon Johnson, mayors and cities now are taking on that responsibility. What I didn't see, although I suppose as they say in life, timing's everything, you have the former mayor of London now as the prime minister of Great Britain. You have Mayor Bloomberg, Bernie
People
used to
forget
be
a, he was the mayor of Burlington.
Burlington, you had yep. Castro of San Antonio, you had Booker of Newark. You had four governors. In the last 100 years, 11 presidents were all governors. They all failed or dropped out. So you have more mayors running today for president in the United States, more than the last 100 years, both parties combined in one cycle. And so it is, and then take a step back, 75% of the public thinks local government they have confidence in. That number is 22 for the national level.
So you start the book not with your own career path, but you start with the story of your grandparents who emigrated here from Eastern Europe. What was the inspiration that you drew from them?
Well, there's a part in the introduction. First of all, I mean, only in this country could the grandson of an immigrant from Eastern Europe who was fleeing the pogroms become, this isn't supposed to calm you down, I hope it does, the chief of staff to a president, let alone the mayor of the city that welcomed him into that. I mean, he came as a 10-year-old by himself. He was put on a boat to flee the pogroms, never to see his mother or his stepfather again, or any other family. Goes to Indiana to meet his father, whose wife rejects him, finds a third cousin on Maxwell Street in Chicago. And in two generations, his grandson is the mayor, but more importantly, he was a truck driver, meat cutter, steel worker. You wouldn't know it looking at me, but he was a boxer. He was 6'3", 280 pounds. He had hands that were like this size, and he usually expressed his love by slugging you. And he would get up at 4:30, and when he lived with us, he and grandma, he would be in his boxer shorts, his tank top, socks, knee-high, slippers, and he'd make you breakfast, would yell at you, which is another expression of love. But he had a fourth grade, fifth grade education. And after he was done making breakfast, he would sit there and read a book or read the paper. And he was self-taught. And he told you everything without words that he expected. And then downstairs, and this is a part of the story, is, and there's nothing subtle in a Jewish home. My mother and father put in a frame my grandmother, Sophie's, purse that had her passport and my two great aunts, all framed. And then on either side of that were black and white photos of the relatives who either died in the Holocaust or died in the pogroms. And it was a very, very poignant that you are not to waste this. There were relatives who never made it here. And you are to use your time in life to do something with your life. And so that was the journey of our family, and then the journey of not mine, but also what other mayors are doing, et cetera.
How about your parents? Your mother, Marcia, was an activist. Your father is a doctor. Your brothers turned out okay. What was it growing?
We all get graded on a curve.
Yeah.
So, okay.
What was that like? I mean, was your growing up with a fairly intense?
There's a couple things. First of all, we never had. It was not a nuclear family like that. Ari and I shared a room because we always had my grandmother on my father's side lived with us for 8 years. My grandparents on my mother's side lived with us for 2 years. Every one of my Aunt Shirley's children, cousins, six of them, all lived with us at some period of time. We had a foster child. My parents adopted. It was like the first Airbnb in America. literally, you met people that were staying, you know, they would stay for a day and they were there at dinner for a week. And a week became a month, and a month became a year. And people just were, and so we had a room reserved for whoever was staying at our house. So it wasn't Ozzie and Harriet nuclear family. We got, we lived on Buena in Chicago, which is an Edgewater neighborhood. And we got kicked out because my mother was the lead for CORE, the Congress on Racial Equality in Chicago, and their landlord did not like all the people and different people of different races coming to the house or the apartment. So we moved to Winona. My dad couldn't speak a word of English, basically. He was from Israel. And he quit the AMA in 1962. He has three kids, maybe 600 words of English. He's trying to start a medical practice, and he quits the AMA in 1962 over national health care because they were opposed to it. Not a great way to start a medical practice if you're trying to do that. My mother is not taking on Richard J. Daley, fighting for open beaches, open housing, et cetera, all in Chicago. And so that's kind of, and then at the dinner, you were expected to have read the paper and have an opinion. And my parents made you, I mean, it had more like we were the first UFC fighting at a dinner table. So it was. But that was what it was about.
That's all you knew.
Yeah, that is all you knew. And somebody else who you never met was having dinner with your family.
You described, and I thought I had picked up the wrong book, but you described yourself as a quiet and attentive child. So what happened? Those are not words that are normally associated.
I've repressed that side of me now. So, you know, the truth is I was quiet, very observant, et cetera, whatever. At 17, the summer I'm going to college, I'm working as a meat cutter. And I shouldn't do this before you have your meal. So anyway, I'm cleaning the blade, I cut it deeply, and I end up with 5 blood infections, 2 bone infections, gangrene, and 105.4 fever. And for about 72 hours, I mean, I was in full ice pack to save me. I was in the hospital for 7 weeks. Actually, a nurse had saved my life. 3 roommates had died. And I, you know, it's not like the sky opened, lightning came through, Beethoven's 9th was playing in the background. But I knew that if I got out of that hospital, I was going to do something with my life. And it was a transformational moment for me. It was literally, I almost died. And I basically decided I was going to live every day to make sure that I counted, which was not my attitude. Beforehand.
Up to that point.
Yeah. So, I mean, I do want to say, my father taught us our work ethic. My mother taught us the values of doing something with our lives. And my grandfather taught us that an education was everything in life.
So you found your way to politics in the early 80s and worked at the DCCC, which was organizes on behalf of all the Democratic campaigns, mm-hmm. congressional campaigns around the country. How did you find that work, and what did you like about it?
I go to college.
Yep.
I was going to be a ballet dancer. I had a scholarship to the Joffrey Ballet School. As soon as my parents drove off, I threw the ballet shoes against the wall. I said, forget this. I didn't want to do it. I then studied, and I wanted to become an early childhood educator. My dad's a pediatrician. I think that was a very big influence. And then, by coincidence, I worked one time in a campaign, and I realized this is really what I love. And then periodical things worked. And I started working, and I set up for, when I got to the DCCC early in my career, I was setting up the national field operation for the Democratic Congressional Campaign for Tony Coelho. And basically, that was the year 1986 that even when in 86, we ended up winning a lot of elections in the sixth year of the Reagan, and then I became the political director in 88. And even though Bush won the presidency, we won three House seats, which was abnormal. And I was the campaign director for that DCCC when that happened.
So you went on to work in the White House. You spent a lot of time on trade, on some of the issues on crime, some of the issues that are still around and still in the ferment. But what you went back with Obama. We could spend some time on that. When did you decide, as this book, that really the action was on the local level? And is that because politics evolved, or you evolved, or a little bit of both?
First of all, I think, you have to look at it in kind of windows of history and time. I kind of see the Teddy Roosevelt to Lyndon Johnson as one big bulk. This happens after wars. You redefine what the federal government can do. That's true about World War I, it's true about World War II. Etc. It's not an accident. After the Civil War, you get the land grant colleges and the transatlantic railroad. After World War II, you get the GI Bill, etc., and you get other investments in America. After the Eisenhower decides the interstate highway system, so you understand that the federal government can do more than you thought before. And and it all goes through to the Great Society, and then there's a loss of confidence because of Vietnam, other things, in the federal government. Now, I think there are structural things, there's technological things, there's economic things, there's societal things. On the structural things, and I'm saying this as somebody who's practiced these dark arts, I think redistricting has been a horrible, debilitating thing to our politics, because rather than elected officials elected officials pick voters. And I think that has polarized politics, where 80% to 85% of the House is now picked in the primary, not the general election. And I used to practice these. There's a really bad influence. I think Citizens United by the Supreme Court has been an absolute disaster to our politics. Then there's economic, cultural, and the diversity of a country, the technology and the transition of the economy, not too dissimilar to in the beginning of the 20th century. But you could see the federal government, and I open up this chapter on education, it's why I ran for mayor. Lyndon Johnson sees all the burning of cities. Comes with the model city, comes with Head Start, early childhood education, as a benefit both to his belief, he was a teacher in early childhood education. Also though, cities are short of money, is also to make sure to take care of the politics locally. Fast forward 50 years later, President Obama wants to create universal full-day pre-K. He cannot get it done. John Boehner, the Republicans stop him, says it's not gonna happen. He has a White House conference on early childhood education with 200 mayors and says, I need you to get this done. So you went from a federal government doing it for local government to local governments doing it for the federal government. And that is the arc of transition. You don't have high expectations for government. And when you think about the things that are happening, that literally, we were just talking earlier about, where do you live? Where do you send your kids to school? How do you get to work? What are the amenities in your neighborhood? What are the parks, the libraries, the services? All those things that you count on for where you live, work, and play are the things your city government does for you. Now, I would prefer taking I'm very proud of what we've done on community college. I would prefer a federal partner. We had to find $12 million a year in a budget to do free community college. But you can't wait. Yeah. And so to me, the center of gravity's moved, and it's gonna move, and it's not snapping back anytime soon.
Yeah. You, one of the first battles, and you talked about it, that you took on as mayor of Chicago was education. You lengthened the school day, you lengthened the school year, you put in place pre-K through college plans. What lessons did you learn in that fight politically?
Promise less in a campaign. So look, and when I said this earlier, when I was in college, I studied child psychology and wanted to be an early childhood educator. And I knew that the values that my grandfather, my mother and father taught us, and the values that I wouldn't be where I was if it wasn't for an education. It is the principal reason I ran for mayor. When I ran in 2011, Chicago had, remember, there's like 7,000 school districts across the United States. It had the shortest school day and the shortest school year in the United States of America. 82-83% of all kids in the Chicago public schools are poverty or below. Just put a legal pad out. If you're designing a way to break the cycle of poverty, would you design the shortest school day in the United States of America? And so I made a pledge, and I use this analogy, that the kids in Houston, K through 12, get 2.5 more years education time than the kids in Chicago, just based on the length of day and the length of year. And also, in the city, half, a little more, about 60-some-odd percent of the kids had a full-day kindergarten, and the other half had a half-day. And it was based on whether parents had the wherewithal to advocate for their children, not based on a city policy. And if you looked at the map of the city, kids who came from well-to-do families or comfortable families or middle-class families, their kids had full-day kindergarten, and kids that came from poverty or below, basically, it was a hit or miss. And so the first, I'm get elected in May of 2011, the contract's up in 2012, and I made a policy, we're not getting out of this contract. And Mayor Daley, in 2003 and 2007 contract, tried to get 45 minutes and 30 minutes, and got both times shut out. He tried. And then the big difference, and I write about this, is, and it's a calculation. I started the job 6'2", I'm now 5'8½, I would be taller. But I decided we were gonna do what it takes because I made a pledge and I thought it was essential to get this. So anyway, it ended up in a 7-day strike, but we ended up getting an hour and 15 minutes to every day, 2 weeks to every year, and universal full-day kindergarten for every child. And then we also, later on in my tenure, added full-day pre-K. I have a firm belief. Children start dropping out of college in fourth grade. They don't drop out freshman year. And if you want them to succeed in fourth grade, reading, math, et cetera, you have to start when they're 4 weeks old, but minimum, you have to start when they're 4 years old. And you have to create a baseline of success. When you add up pre-K, kindergarten, full day, the community college, Chicago added 4 years of educational time to a child. Fast forward, our graduation rate went from 56 to just shy of 80% in 8 years. Our reading and math scores across all demographics were one of the fastest growing. And New York Times reported from a Stanford professor of studies, Sean Reardon, said Chicago's kids are outpacing 97% of all other children across the United States, suburban, rural, in academic growth. And to me, and I love politics, I love policy, if you're gonna go into public service, you wanna actually, especially children, leave their lives better off than before. We've made tough decisions and things that you don't run to do, but you gotta get done. But that was why we ran, that's why I ran. I say we because of my family, and made the effort in education to get, I think, dramatic things done.
One of the issues that you talk quite a bit about what cities have done is climate, and that seems like the classic global federal issue that should be solved at a supranational level, but also at the national level, and yet, you know, cities have rushed into that void. So what do you see as the long run there, if cities are trying to deal with it, but you've got a lot of other factors at play. What can cities do and what can't they do?
You know, I came into it, two things. We had two coal plants operating in the city, the only city with it, and it was all in poor neighborhoods. And I told the California utility, I said, I'm just telling you this right now. Natural gas is going to shut your coal plant. You can either wait for the market to do it, or I'll throw you a parade if you shut it down unilaterally. And there have been a big battle for 20 years. They're both in Pilsen and back of the yards, historic Hispanic communities, Mexican-American working class communities in Chicago. Called about 2 weeks later and says, what color is the confetti? And so he made a decision. I knew enough about natural gas prices that this was going to happen. We shut those down. We did other things as it relates to climate change. Put about 54 million square feet under retrofit. Now, the truth is mayors should take a leadership. Cities are one of the biggest contributors to greenhouse gas emissions, both car, buildings, et cetera. So they should lead. But the truth is you need a federal government that incentivizes certain policies. You can't do it in a patchwork-like effort. Now, you can't also sit there and say, well, there's no federal government. I'm absolved of my responsibility. Now, this is a classic also of the ideas of ideas moving horizontally. The mayor of Paris, who's the leader in this issue, dear friend, we agreed that we would not just celebrate the Paris Agreement now that Trump had walked away. So we created a major conference in the city of Chicago. It's called the Chicago Climate Charter. And every city that signed it, based on the mayor, had a customized plan built to the city. Their road, so Waukegan, Illinois, Vancouver, Canada, had a specific plan to their city of how they were going to achieve the Paris Agreement by 2025. Again, that's an example of where the cities have taken leadership. Nobody asked the State Department. Nobody asked the Department of Commerce. Nobody checked whether it was okay with the United Nations. And about 79 mayors across the North America and Europe all signed in and pledged, and with a very specific data-sensitive, data-specific accountability to how they're going to get to Paris 2025.
A couple questions. Who's your favorite brother?
I'll tell you, my mother, so I used to, we're all, Zeke's 2 years older, Ari is 16 months younger to the day. And I used to say to my mother, you love Zeke more than you love me. She said, no, I hate you all equally. Okay. That's all you got to know about what happened in our house.
Favorite hobby? Do you have any hobbies?
Yeah. I have a couple hobbies. I work out a lot because when I almost died, the doctor said I would have died if I hadn't worked out. And I keep, but now it's become neurosis.
You still swim?
3 miles. I did it this morning. A mile three times a week. Yoga 3 times a week. Weights. My favorite hobby, though, is reading. Yeah. I read constantly, about a book every 3 weeks.
Best advice you've gotten?
I was running for Congress. Late Senator Paul Simon from Illinois said every year, I would say two things. Paul Simon said every year, update your 5-year plan. Then my father, and I kept this tradition with my children where they got bar and bat mitzvah. He would take you somewhere special. My dad just died, so this is hard, a little hard. And on my bar mitzvah, which is true for all the kids, he would quote Rabbi Hillel, who are you if you're not for yourself? What are you if you're only for yourself? And if not now, then when? And he says, now that you're becoming an adult, your quest in life is to try to figure out how to answer that question.
All right, Rahm, thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Giving us a little taste of the passion and energy.